if I lose my Swiss citizen residence permit, it's your fault. So the talk is called Dissecting the Rabbit, RabbitMQ Internal Architecture. See? These are probably coming from Switzerland. And the idea is to show how RabbitMQ uses the Erlang processes system to be implemented. It's a new talk that I finished preparing 20 minutes ago, so. Good talk, good luck to the speaker. And yeah, that's me. You can find me in those places and so on. The this GitHub, this blog has articles on the internals of RabbitMQ, if you want to learn more. How many of you use Erlang? Ah, tricks. how many of you use Rabbit? OK, so a lot of people use Rabbit, not so many use Erlang. And I wrote this book. You can download it from the Russian website or buy it. And wherever you buy books here. And yeah, we are hiring at the RabbitMQ team. And since we are in a functional programming conference, I'm telling you there is a better closure. You can start using it today. It's called Closure, and it's for real. So just go there and get off of the darkness of Closure. Okay? And as he said, I'm from Uruguay, and I know you guys love everybody from Uruguay, specifically this guy. So if you're from the south of Italy, deal with it, sorry. And we also gave you the other guy. You know El Mundialito? This is when we gave you Berlusconi, so. never let an Uruguayan in your country. That's, I mean, it broke you twice, and you keep letting us in, so. too late. Now you will change all for Erlang, and you will be doomed in 2 years or so. Anyway, so the idea is to give an intro to Rabbit and then see what's going on inside. And this three parts is the one they told me to remove. So if you want to know about that, we'll see it later. So I like to always try to get on the same page so everybody knows what I'm talking about. And there might be people that don't know RabbitMQ, and there might be people looking later in the video that also don't know Rabbit. So Rabbit is a multi-protocol messaging server. It's open source on the Mozilla public license. Polyglot, in the sense that you can connect to it from different languages, and you can add extensions also, for example, in Elixir. There was a talk recently about it. Sadly, I don't know if it's the guy that did the Elixir talk here. No, for later, you were wrong. Erlang is better, okay? And written in Erlang OTP, yeah? That's what we are going to see later. You can choose your mustache or protocol, AMQP, MQTT, and Stomp. AMQP is the default one. There are many versions of it. As I said yesterday in another talk, and probably Flavio will agree, there are many versions of AMQP, and if you have like a Coliseo Romano around here, we can go and fight and decide with punches which one is the best one, because there is no other way to decide, okay? So besides the AMQP, there is MQTT and Stomp. MQTT is for the Internet of Things, kind of protocol from IBM, is an open protocol and so on. And Stomp is a text-based protocol, which, for example, Stomp is used at the CERN for the Large Hadron Collider. So, next, polyglot, I said. You can connect from all these languages. The different, mostly the Java library, the .NET, and the Erlang, and they're supported officially by the RabbitMQ team. The others are kind of supported by the community, but most of the time, we just work at RabbitMQ as well. So, I maintain the PHP library. The node library was created by a former RabbitMQ developer, and he also, I think, was kind of designer of AMQP, or was in the committee at least. The Ruby library is maintained by a colleague, and the Haskell library, as I always say, First, it's written in Haskell. There are no bugs in Haskell. You know that. Secondly, it's written by a German guy, so there are no bugs either. So it's very, very simple how you do things in programming, right? And sorry, yeah, we also have COBOL. This is from Hewlett Packard. I think this guy works at HP. And yeah, if you are in that inferno, you can talk to Dante and or the guy with the boat to take you out. No. Sorry? Caronte, exacto. Yeah, how can I forget the main poem of Italy where you got your standard language and you basically told all the old people stop talking your dialect, right? So, but Dante was not Uruguayan, so don't blame us in this case. So Instagram is using Rabbit, yeah, blah, 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 nice marketing slide, basically. But yeah, there are a lot of use cases. Mercado Libre, this is like the eBay of Latin America, which, by the way, at the Elixir talk, the guy had a slide where it says Latin lovers. I'm a Latino, I was like, what is this? But Latin lovers is people that love the Latin language. So I'm learning stuff in this conference. And yeah, Mozilla, every time Mozilla crashes, RabbitMQ will get a report and so on. So we are inspecting your rabbits. And yeah, Mercado Libre, Latin America is the biggest, like the eBay of Latin America. You can think of the population of Mexico, Brazil, Argentina, everywhere going there to buy stuff. So it's quite big as a project. Yeah, you can install on those platforms. And now I want to show you basically how things work. So nice Mundialito, a nice guy, and this. So this is the Rabbit simulator. And the idea in RabbitMQ or AMQP is that you have producers sending data to consumers. And to send data, you need an address. In AMQP, it's called the exchange. When you connect the producer to the exchange and send data, it ends there. The problem is that we don't have a queue. If we have a queue bound to the exchange, then the messages will be routed to the queue. And finally, with the consumer, we can connect it to the queue and receive the messages. So if you want to have more speed, faster consumer or faster processing of messages, you can add more consumers. And RabbitMQ takes care of doing the load balancing of messages. And then the exchange is like, why do you even have an exchange? Why not sending directly to the queue? The exchange actually is like the coupling of I publish message, but I don't care where the message ends up. So this might be better like this. When I connect another queue there and I send messages, then they will be kind of fan out to both queues. And the thing is, like with the exchange, we can have, in this case, different routing keys. As an example, I can have an routing key for int, meaning international. I tell you right away what this is, and local. So in Switzerland, for example, when you buy tickets for trains, you go to the train station, there is a computer, you press, I want ticket for local transportation. So you go there, you will be put in a queue, and if there is an available counter, you get your ticket. Assuming they like you and they want to sell you something, because, you know, Auslanders, raus, if you know German. And then another one wants to buy a local ticket, an international, sorry, you go to the other queue. So the exchange will be this machine they have there to direct you to queues, and then whenever your number appears on the screen, you go to the counter that belongs to you, let's say. So that kind of decoupling is what the exchange is doing. Or also, if you go to the Apple Store, you don't need to know the structure of every Apple Store in the world to get what you want. You just go there, talk to a guy or girl or woman, and ask her, like, I want to buy an iPhone. Then they will say, OK, talk there. I want to fix my computer. Go there. You don't really care about the structure of the Apple Store and what they do and so on. So that also will be kind of an exchange routing messages. And in RabbitMQ or in AMQP, there are at least three kinds of exchanges, direct, fan out, and topic. I won't go into details on each of them, but the difference is the algorithm they implement. The direct exchange is saying, match this message, like select from queues where routing key equals binding key. This is the binding key here, and the one local there, and the one I used to publish is the routing key. By the way, in the MQP specification, they exchange these terms, so you can call them whatever you want. That's why there is a spec, right? To just to use whatever word you want. That's the very good things about the MQP. It's a very nice spec. But if you're not watching the video, you don't even see my things. Anyway, the direct exchange will do this kind of selection of queues. Then you have fan out, where the routing keys are not taken into account anymore. So the messages are fan out to all the bound queues, like that. And the last one is the topic exchange, where you have, again, routing keys, but you can also use patterns. So you can bind the queue with something like hash.info. That means send me all the messages whose routing key ends in info. But you can say star.application1.info. That means I don't care. For example, the original message could be server1.application1.info, but that will be just a normal direct exchange, right? But I can say star, and I say, I don't care which server made the log, just send if they come from application one. But then you can say, maybe it's not the application, I want to care all of them. You do that. But maybe back again, you want server two here. You can do that combination and so on. If you have the hash, it means whatever comes before, dot info, and so on. So, do you have questions about the exchanges, AMQP model, things happening there?
Fan out actually replicates the messages.
So all the exchanges replicate messages in a sense, what it means. So if I have topic, sorry, direct. And if I have here local again, and then I send a message as local, it also goes to both. The messages internally, they are only replicated in an index. Rabbit keeps track of, has an index table, knowing where the messages are going, but the body of the message is only once, stored once, to save memory and disk space. So the queues are kind of logical things that know they have messages, but yeah. Another question? No? Okay. So back to the slides. So that is basically the AMQP model. Sorry for the noise. The AMQP model and what RabbitMQ is trying to implement. You have a publisher. You have consumers trying to get the messages. The exchange is the address where you send messages. You can have many of those exchanges, and the queues there will be bound and so on. When the publisher or the consumer wants to get connected to Rabbit, of course they need to open a TCP connection or SSL connection, and then internally RabbitMQ or MQP uses something called channels. And the channels are a way to multiplex the connection, and that's what we see how RabbitMQ uses Erlang in that particular place. Which, by the way, channels, I don't know if you are familiar with Enterprise Integration Architecture, this book. Is the channels of RabbitMQ are not the channels of that book. A channel in that book might be a queue, or might be an exchange, or might be a combination of queue and exchange, and so on. I make this clear because the other day we had a guy on IRC saying, is this my channel, blah, blah, blah? And they say, no, this is the AMQP model document explanation, blah, blah. Yeah, yeah, but I want to keep calling channels whatever he was reading that book. Okay, cool, but here they are not these things, okay? Anyway, internals. When we open a connection, our channel, this is Erlang code. You know Erlang? Some people say, no, OK, I asked this already. My memory is not so long term. So this equal sign is not the assignment you are used to from other programming languages. This in Erlang is kind of doing pattern matching, which means, in this case, that the expression on the left has to match the expression on the right. In this case, AMQP connection start is a call of the start function on the AMQP connection module. We pass a record called AMQP params, network, and one field of the record is localhost. Of course, you can have user, passwords, port, blah, blah, blah. So AMQP connection start, we return OK, a tuple with OK, and with a connection. And in the case of Erlang, because it's doing pattern matching, if connection is the first time that it's being used, that variable is not bound. It means it's just a name, but has no content inside. So this matches, assuming start succeeds. So if start succeeds, will be OK, plus some pointer or PID to the connection. Fine. So if I call again AMQP connection start, it will fail because connection, it already has some value inside, and this function will create a new connection. So in Erlang, you cannot vary variables. They are more like mathematics variables. Then I have the connection. I use it here to create a new channel. And AMQP connection open channel returns OK channel, same concept as before. The question is, what's going on here? What happens internally in Rabbit? That's what happens. I'm pretty sure you cannot read that. It's fine. But the idea, because it's not meant to be read, I will go step by step later. The idea is that you see the main structure, that there is a start of a tree, and then this tree starts getting many branches. All these boxes are processes in RabbitMQ or in Erlang. So back to Erlang. When we have an Erlang application, we will have processes, which may be thousands of them. In Erlang, we run in an Erlang virtual machine. We are not running like in C, that you just execute the code directly and so on. I mean, it's like Java. You have this virtual machine interpreting the code and executing commands, let's say. And the way this works in Erlang is that you have kind of an operating system in this virtual machine where you have all these processes. And for example, if you want to read stuff from the connection, you will have a process that reads things from the connection. You want to write to the file system, you have a process that takes care of writing to the file system, and so on. On a web app, you can have a process to handle each request. But the thing is, with Erlang, they are not mapped to threads on the operating system. They are like lightweight processes into this Erlang virtual machine that will take care of doing scheduling and all that. So the processes, they communicate sending messages. They don't have access to each other memory. Each process has a message queue, which of course is not the RabbitMQ message queue. And this message queue can also blow up. If you don't read messages from the message queue, at some point it will memory explode. And Erlang, if you run out of memory, calls exit. So Rabbit used to have this bug in the version 1.7, like 5 years ago, maybe. You will run out of memory and like, good luck. So now we try to prevent that. But in Erlang, it's common that you will, I don't know, you know about selective receive in Erlang? In Erlang, when you receive a process, you call a statement in the, no, it's not a statement, but in the language you call receive, I want to receive messages, and then the process will block, waiting for certain types of messages. If you don't match all the possible types that your process will get, the mailbox will start filling up because you are taking, let's say, the make me a pizza message, make me soup and lasagna, but you forgot that somebody may want coffee. I don't know. So when all these make me coffee messages will stay on the mailbox, and at some point it blow up. So in Erlang, there are ways to prevent that. It's pretty easy. It's like how you will build an app. You already build that into your app. But you need to know that this may happen if you don't take care of this. And the virtual machine has this preemptive scheduler. So the difference that Erlang has, for example, with Orleans, I don't know if you know Orleans from F-sharp or from Microsoft. Orleans or Orleans, I don't know how they pronounce it. It's an actor model for Microsoft systems, for .NET, and it was used for building the backends of the Halo game. Like the whole game backend is actually built in this actor model, Orleans. But because it's running as normal threads on .NET, they don't have this preemptive scheduler. So if some task blocks doing something, you block everything. In the case of Erlang, they don't do that. Each process has a certain amount of instructions or reduction that it can execute, and after this credit expired or was used completely, a new process is scheduled, and so on and so on, and then the scheduler knows, I mean, like a normal, like operating system scheduler. But the thing is, they are preempted. That's quite important. Because for the telco system where Erlang was created, they needed this kind of soft, real-time properties in the virtual machine that you won't block the system. Like, I'm making a phone call, and then for some reason, everything blocks there. And then somebody has tried to make a phone call, and maybe we accept the phone call, but we don't cherish that phone call. So Ericsson couldn't be losing money like that, let's say. So if you want to read more, this blog post by Jesper is very into details of how Erlang works. As you can see, I was in Russia when I made this slide, so that is .ru. I was downloading my book. So if you go to Jesper's blog, he has a lot of things about internals of Erlang. It's really, really interesting. So back to Erlang. The structure is in the code is very simple in Erlang. You have modules, functions. Functions have an arity, that is how many arguments the function takes. So a function called ciao that takes only one argument is not the same as a call ciao with two arguments for the compiler and so on. And then the arguments are just whatever you pass. And this concept is you find it everywhere in Erlang. In Erlang libraries, Erlang documentation, all the places you will find MFA, which is, of course, module, function, and arguments. So we will see it later. And if you later start learning Erlang, for the one that that don't know it yet, don't go to Elixir, please. If you start using reading the docs, you will see MFA every time. When I was learning Erlang, I was like, what's that? So in RabbitMQ, for example, a client supervisor has a module attribute saying the module name. Everything that has this dash is a module attribute. So this file has to be called rabbit-client-sup.erl. It has to match the name. Then behavior, the creators of Erlang are British, as you can see. Supervisor 2, it says that it's implementing this behavior, which is similar to an interface, similar but not really like an interface in Java, for example. And then it tells that it's exporting these functions, startlink 1, startlink 2, and so on. Startlink, the name, the number is the number of arguments accepted by the function. There is a second export, which is init. Why we do this? In Erlang, when you have a behavior, like supervisor 2, you need to implement this interface. In this case, StartLink and StartLink worker, I guess. And we tend to separate the functions we export because the behavior asks for those functions versus the normal API of the module. So this will be the API of the module. And then we just include some headers from Rabbit. And that's the code. We don't need to understand. We don't need to see anything there, just to see how the rest of the module goes. Implementation of StartLink with only one argument, with two arguments, the init function, which takes module function arguments, and we'll do some magic there. And the other one, if you want to start a worker process, we will see later what is that. So,
will you go to supervisor 2 later, or is that for offline talk?
Offline talk. This is the first part of the file and the second file part of the file, and that's the whole thing. So he asked about supervisor 2. Why is it not called supervisor? This is something invented or created, better say, by the RabbitMQ team. And it's used today in various forms inside other Erlang projects that you find inside React. I think this mem-based or whatever it was, this Erlang memcache thing. And here is supervisor 2 for you. Your questions are probably answered there. So supervisor without the 2 is a normal Erlang module that comes with Erlang OTP. Supervisor 2 is the one that RabbitMQ added. For example, there is a function fanchild 2 that lets you find that child of a process. And there are different things that are supported. But besides that, it's the same as the supervisor and the normal one. But you can go to that file and read it later. So in Erlang, I told you the main concept or the main idea of Erlang is to have all these processes that talk to each other. That's how you structure your apps. And when you want to create a process, you call the spawn function. You pass a function like it's like a higher order function, if we want to talk FP today. And you can also pass a node saying spawn this function, but in a different Erlang virtual machine. And you can also pass the module function arguments. I don't know if you know this also, but in Erlang, it's really easy to have to form a cluster. You have two machines. You start the Erlang VM in both. And when you ping from one from the other, they automatically get connected. In that case, you can say, start this process in the other virtual machine, for example. Then the problem with starting a lot of processes is how we do fault tolerance. And in Erlang, there is the concept of links. In this case, we have a process A that also has a process, started a process B, but it told the runtime that it wants to trap exit. I will tell you what it is. And also, it's linked to it. If you don't do the trap, if process B dies, A dies as well. But if you trap exit, A can do something with it, for example. So when this dies, a message will travel back through the link saying exit B and Y. And I'm missing a comma there. So in the normal case, when you are not trapping exits, if B dies, A dies, cool. But you probably want to know when things die. Like in RabbitMQ, if a channel dies, if a queue dies, you want to know that the queue is gone. Like you don't want to then keep publishing messages. Messages arrive to the exchange. Then they are going to be routed to some queue, and this queue is gone. It's not there anymore. There have to be a way to take care of that. Erlang has this built-in with the trap exit thing. So in this case, the process A knows something was wrong with B. So as Joe Armstrong explained in his book, Programming Erlang, There are some idioms. For example, one could be, I don't care if a process I create crashes. That means you do a spawn of a function. If this spawn process crashes, the one doing this call will crash as well. My bad. In this case, the other crashes, you have no idea that even it crashed. In the linked version, then you know and you crash. And why is called spawn link and not you call spawn and then you call link? Because this is kind of atomic. It's like one operation that does the whole thing. Because you could do a spawn and then the process dies before you link. So a spawn link takes care of doing everything at once. And if you want to handle the errors, you do this process flag, trap exit true, and you do the link. So in this case, whoever calls this will get this message back saying the other process died. So there are two kinds of processes, the normal ones and the system ones. The system ones are the ones that know when the other process crashed, but they don't crash themselves. And we can say that with normal processes, we can implement workers, and with the other, we can implement this famous supervisor. So we arrive to supervision trees. The whole idea here is that there will be a tree of hierarchy of processes where some processes will take care of starting another, like workers, and making sure they're still alive, and doing some actions depending of if this process died and why they died. So we started with a very simple concept of having a process as a unit of concurrency, execution, and so on. Then we know that, okay, I want to know if my other process that I just started is crash, or I want to be notified if it crashes. So we had links, but then I don't want to die if the other process crashes, so we have trap exits, and so on. From all those basic things, we can build these trees. So as a semi-rant, when people say, I have an actor model, I have Erlang, no, that's not the point of Erlang. For Erlang, I mean, I shouldn't even be here because Erlang is not a functional language in the sense that we want to create a functional language like Haskell, for example. Erlang is functional by accident because to do concurrency and to prevent side effects and so on, then they had to build a functional language, but not necessarily for what they wanted to solve as a problem. And in the same sense, we also have this supervision tree and everything. So having an actor model, cool story, bro. But you need to have a supervision tree to actually handle all the errors, which is something I want to learn more later about Orleans, because they don't have these things. So I want to know how they do things in case of failure. So that's how this thing looks like. And yeah, we have the concept of workers, the supervisors, and this hierarchy. You can read more there. And this is how everything starts. This thing that looks like the worst thing that ever happened to your eyes is not that bad. Because when your eyes want to be closed and sleeping quietly at home, this thing will save you from being waken up, okay? So it's not that bad. This is what is called the client specification, like a supervisor based on this info now knows how to start a worker, for example. So in this case, the simple one-for-one is kind of the way these workers are arranged for the supervisor. I will tell you what it is now. This is called the restart strategy. So what is in strong black there is the restart strategy. One-for-one, it means that we only restart the failing process. We have a group of baristas serving coffee. One of them fainted, we kick it out, and we put another one there. So problem solved. That would be the one-for-one. One-for-all. We restored the failing processes and all its siblings. We went to some ATM machine, and they're running Windows. And one of them crashed, the whole system is gone. They restart all of them, and they put it back together. That's the one for all. Simple one for all, for one is a simplified version of one for one. What does it even mean? It means that you can actually dynamically add workers to that one. Instead of having a specific set of workers from startup, you can keep adding them at runtime, and Rabbit does that in the channel management thing. Max R and max T is how many restarts are allowed in this amount of seconds. So this one cannot restart because it's zero in 1 second. Then is the actual spec of the children, poodle child. So that's in Erlang, it's not a type language, but we have a lot of these specs that kind of tell you what the type of something is. So the ID is a term. There is the thing saying client, for example. So that's how you want to identify this worker. Start function, the supervisor needs to know how to start this worker, and it needs a module function and arguments. And the arguments, you can see, is a list of terms, a list of Erlang terms. Restart, the supervisor needs to know what to do when the worker dies, how to restart it, and so on. I will go later to that. Shutdown, Game of Thrones oriented development, basically, brutal kill and the others. You kill children all the time in Erlang, that's true. And type, worker or supervisor. And I have a very bad joke to say, but I don't know if it's appropriate. But I think in Italy and my Latin countries, instead of being worker and supervisor, it should be politicians and the rest. Next, the modules, and I just made this joke on time, so never, I shouldn't trust my head so much, I guess. Modules, this is, we don't go in here, but in Erlang, you can release your call in a package, and then you can tell which modules your app is handling. We don't go there, but it's basically, when you do hot call reloading in Erlang, this is the system for handling this thing. So we have this spec again back as one. And I told you there is the restart. Permanent means should always be restarted. Temporary should never be restarted. And transient is restarted only if terminated abnormally. So in this reason that comes back to this, to the, my process is monitoring this other process. I get a reason back why the other crashed. In this reason, I know if it crashed abnormally or just exits because we want to stop working or whatever, like it's time to go home. So this is here. It's restarted only if terminated abnormally. Temporary, never restarted. It crashed, it's gone. In RabbitMQ, if I lose a channel where the client was sending commands and receiving commands, I guess, I'm not sure what is in the code, but I will guess it's probably temporary. Because what are you going to restart if the other peer is gone? In permanent should always be there. If we, for example, the network thing that receives messages from the network in Rabbit, the process, I'm pretty sure it has to be permanent. Because if this thing is not there anymore, then we don't have a broker anymore, right? Then brutal kill, the child is terminated immediately. When, let's say, you stop RabbitMQ, brutal kill. And could be one of the things. Or a timeout. You have this timeout of seconds to clean up your state and close. Infinity, we give enough time to shut down. In the case of a queue, you probably want to give infinity because you want to, the queue to persist everything to disk before shutting down. So that's what's there. So we have not so much time, but we can see that the guys, when they design Erlang with this simple, not so simple thing actually, but when you see why it's there, you start making sense of all the thought they put when they design Erlang and all these things. Having an actor model, as I say, yeah, cool. But with just these flags that we tweak here, we can say, if I have a network listener, I need some way of restarting. If I have a queue process, I have a different way, and so on. That, for me, is one of the big things of Erlang and OTP and so on. So back to this thing that you probably cannot read. When you create a connection, you get this whole structure for you. On the top, we have a process called RabbitTCP Client Supervisor. You have a new connection. A connection supervisor is started. We have a queue collector, intermediate supervisor, and a reader. This one is the one that will actually read messages, read TCP packets, basically, and convert them to the AMQP commands. We have this intermediate thing here because for this supervisor to know when to restart things, it has to be at the same time of all this together. So it's related. It seems like a hack, and it's really a hack for the tree structure when to restart these things here. Then, the intermediate supervisor will have another supervisor, which is the supervisors of supervisors. This is really bureaucracy here. And then we have the actual channel supervisor, and finally the channel. This channel will take publishes, exchange declare, queue declare, and so on, and will write them to the network. And the limiter is to limit to not, like, to do a control flow, to not overflow and kill processes. Why we need a supervisor of supervisors? Because if you open a new channel on the same connection, you will have this structure replicated. If this channel crashes because it does something that is not allowed by the spec or an exception and so on, we don't want to kill this channel. This channel is working perfectly. You are publishing messages here with no problems. But then here you send an ACK for a message that doesn't exist. The spec says you need to kill the channel. So this is gone, but this is still there. And the supervisor knows what to do with that other process there. And if you have, let's say, three different channels, you get this thing replicated. If you open a new connection, the second layer of the tree will have more layers, for example. So questions about this, because we are already 4 minutes to the end. Yes?
For just 1 millimeter there, is that because you do multiplexing?
Sorry.
There's just 1 millimeter for a connection.
Yeah. Okay. So this reader then knows how to dispatch to which channel. Because each channel internally has an ID, so then they are matched to the processes. But if you open a new connection, you will have a new thing here. Let me see if I can show you this. Erlang has this monitoring observer app. This is Rabbit running now in my system, and these are all the processes. And the TCP client supervisor now doesn't have any, OK, you can read that, sorry. But the supervisor doesn't have any children. If I go here and search for the language of Doom, AKA PHP, I start a consumer in PHP. This will just consume from a queue. This is consuming there. And if this updated, now the supervisor has the connection. One of these is probably the reader and so on, and the whole channel structure. I show you, like, there was a channel supervisor and the three other processes it supervises. If I go to the other terminal and I start a new one, then this should replicate the structure. So, and with Erlang, you can inspect the system. This is running a separate virtual machine than my RabbitMQ server, for example. So, yeah, I think it's quite cool that everything that's there. Questions? Yes?
About something you said before about the queues.
Mm-hmm.
That RabbitMQ queues are a different thing than
Yes.
Does it mean RabbitMQ queues are implemented? How are they implemented?
So a RabbitMQ queue is an Erlang process. This process, as a normal Erlang process, has its own queue, message queue, and so on. But it synchronizes when to write messages to disk, when to send them to consumers, how to synchronize consumers, because a consumer in RabbitMQ can specify a basic quality of service, telling Rabbit, you need to send me at least 10 messages at a time. So this queue process knows that I will send you 10 messages, and then I grab the next consumer and send them 100 if they ask for 100, let's say. So all this coordination is done by the process that implements the queue, which is an Erlang process. For example, when you publish a message on the channel process then just send a message to the queue process saying, you got this new delivery. And for example, if you are confirming messages, that is, you are asking Rabbit to reply to you once it received the message, the queue process then needs to send a message back to the channel telling, I already persisted this message. And then this message will go back via the writer somewhere there to your TCP connection and so on. But it's all messages going around in the Erlang virtual machine, and everything is, of course, has its own queue and so on internally from Erlang. Questions? Yes. With the what, sorry?
With respect with the disk I/O, I mean, how do these messages are saved somewhere?
Ah, okay. So the question is how the messages are persisted and so on. So RabbitMQ implements its own message store, which takes care of writing stuff to the file system. And depending on how you publish the message, persistent or not, or if there is a memory pressure, like Rabbit tried to keep a cache of messages on the memory, but maybe start growing too much, needs to persist to disk. The message store takes care of all that. And it's, I'm not sure if it's an Erlang process or if the queue process just use this module to persist. Like, I know it's using like composition, like in OOP, when you start the queue process, it will have its own store where it writes messages. Yeah, and this store is global for the whole RabbitMQ node. So it's probably sending messages to it, I guess. Questions? Not for the talk, because we don't have time, but take a look at Rabbit behaviors. This is from Erlang, but Rabbit adds a lot of them. So exchange queues, all this stuff is implemented as an Erlang behavior and lets you plug your own. So you can plug your own persister, for example, or a new exchange with, now I'm implemented exchange for scheduling messages. Like if you want to delay message 5 seconds, let's say, I'm implementing a new exchange for that with this. And yes, cool. This is the source code. We recently moved to GitHub. Wow, we are in the 20th century again. or 21st, and questions already gone? Thank you.